Welcome back to the Budget Gamer channel, where we bring you critical and in-depth reviews of just about every indie game we can get our hands on, and today we're going to be taking a look at Under the Jolly Roger for the Nintendo Switch. So if you are a gamer who enjoys the idea of scouring the world to get their hands on some booty, then this might just be the game for you. But I realized after I said that it makes it sound more like a pirate-themed dating sim, which is completely not the case. So if that is what you were expecting, this is not the game you were looking for. But jumping back into the game review, Under the Jolly Roger is actually an open-world RPG with some slight elements of management thrown in. Of course, by the title itself, you can tell that this is a pirate-themed game, and as the story goes, you already were a pirate captain, or some sort of captain of a seafaring vessel. And upon unleashing the final volley to devastate your foe's ship, they call up the Kraken to destroy you and take you down with them. And this is essentially how the game starts, and how you, as a former pirate captain, have to start all over from scratch. Though oddly enough, despite your familiarity with the nautical life and with piracy itself, you do have to start over with the tutorial. The tutorial in the game shows you, as you would expect, how to navigate your ship, how to engage in battle, how to pick and fill out a crew, as well as a few other things like how to buy items, because trading actually is a pretty big part of the game. But finally, after you do finish the tutorial, you're unleashed with your own ship to go and scour the seas, follow quests, and find any mysterious lands you might stumble upon. And of course, the further you make it out into this barren map, the more beautifully it populates and the more random quests you may stumble upon, as well as a couple unknown lands that you can possibly disembark to see if you can scavenge any goods from some other pirate crew's pirate cache. The actual gameplay itself, though, not only consists of roving around the world's main map, but gives you access to several other maps of increasing difficulty. But no matter where you're sailing your ship, you're going to be able to encounter dozens, hundreds of pirate battles, just anywhere you may happen to be roving through open water. Thankfully, though, if your ship has been beat up through some oceanic battles from a quest, there is absolutely no penalty for skipping any of the randomized battles. But as destroying a trade or a pirate ship will get you some gold and possibly some supplies, and of course capturing the ship gives you access to another ship or some salvage to sell, there are definitely some benefits to taking advantage of some of the random encounters. But that being said, the quests are really liberal. If you've ever played anything like an open world RPG from maybe the Morrowind series or maybe other pirate themed games like, I don't know, Assassin's Creed, you're probably already aware of just how prolific side quests can be. And in this game, other than trading or defeating ships in random encounters, fulfilling these quests is going to be the best way to top off your resources. But regardless of which quest lines you choose to engage in, there are very, very few, if any, that don't eventually end in some sort of enemy encounter. And this is essentially where one of the management aspects of the game comes in. You will have to buy your own resources, and there are several types of projectiles you can fire at enemy ships. Starting off in the game at nearly every single port, you'll have access to cannonballs which you can use to wreck or destroy a ship, as well as projectiles specifically meant to damage the crew or damage the sails. And these last two especially will be necessary if you actually want to capture an enemy ship, because first you'll have to strand it in the water and then board it and take on its crew. And while wrecking ships and capturing them do get you a certain amount of gold, you will have to buy every single necessity in the game, including cannonballs, which the more engagements you catch yourself in do get pretty expensive. And taking a quick peek at any of the ports if you do intend to modify your ship or outrig it with any special bonuses will give you a pretty good idea of just how darn expensive this game can get. Not only that, as I mentioned before, a big aspect of the game is your crew complement. You will have to hire every sailor on your crew, and engaging in battles does have the chance to get them killed. But with selecting your quest lines, figuring out how to engage with certain types of ships in battle, and managing and caring for your crew, the life under the Jolly Roger can get pretty difficult. But moving away from the general RPG mechanics of the game, looking at the visuals, they're pretty decent. Cruising through the overworld map does have that really cool pen and ink aesthetic, but if you press the little minus button on your controller, you can drop your ship into the water for a third-person view. It does make for a lot slower navigation, but for a lot prettier scenery. The audio of the game, though, does, at least to me, get a little bit repetitive. The sounds of the ocean are really nice, and the cannon fire I thought was really well done. But for a game where you're going to spend hours and hours cruising around the ocean just looking to pick fights, there's really not much in the audio that's going to hook you in. And now it's actually time to get to everyone's favorite part of the reviews, the critiques. And yes, Under the Jolly Roger, even as a $20 game, does have a fair amount of things that a player would want to know about before they dive in. And first off would probably be the game's price. While $20 might seem obscenely cheap on certain other consoles, on the Nintendo Switch, that's actually kind of a high price, especially considering the indie market. And while the game does provide potentially countless hours of gameplay, the gameplay also is something to note. The largest part of the game is going to be sailing around and engaging in naval battles, and in all honesty, the controls are pretty good. That is, the controls are pretty good as far as the actual sailing of the vessel goes. But probably one of the coolest, or potentially the coolest aspects of the game is boarding another ship and taking it for your own. This gives you access to potentially faster or stronger vessels and gives you a huge wealth of cash to push you further in the game. But whether you're landing on an unknown island or boarding the deck on another ship, that rough, choppy, third-person combat is just, well, I can't say that it's broken, because it does work, but it's just really difficult to manage and clunky. Moving on from the actual physical off-ship combat, which I could say a lot of things about, though, are the other aspects of the game besides sailing around and blowing stuff up. There are a lot of RPG elements to the game, such as hiring and managing your crew, developing their stats to become better sailors, and managing and trading commodities between ports to hopefully get some capital to buy some upgrades. But these just seem, especially in consideration of the price, really underdeveloped. The characters and the crew have very little going on except for their difference of image, and the leveling up and crew management system is sparse to say the least. And while that might actually be a great thing for someone who just wants to sail around the ocean and engage in enemy combat, anyone who's intending to purchase Under the Jolly Roger specifically for that gritty in-depth management portion of the game will probably be fairly disappointed. And so overall, taking a step back and looking at Under the Jolly Roger as a full total package with its pros, its cons, its price, its length, I can safely say that it was definitely a fun and entertaining experience. But whether it's worth the complete asking price is totally going to depend on what you're intending to get out of the game. It's probably not nearly on the same level as some other oceanic pirate-themed games, even older ones, but it does have some really cool aesthetics, and the ocean battles are actually pretty fun. And given that quests pop up again and again, and you can find random stuff, and the exploration system is pretty good, if not taking a really long time to get from point to point, there definitely is fun to be had, but my own personal advice would probably be to wait for a sale. But that does about wrap up the review of Under the Jolly Roger, now on the Nintendo Switch. So if you enjoyed the review, or especially if you found it helpful, feel free to throw us a like or a comment to show your support. And don't forget to click that little bell icon when you subscribe to stay updated with the latest content. We've got new reviews coming out every week, and if you've even seen the eShop once, you know how many crazy unique indie games are out there. So whether it's an unforgettable gem or an easy hard pass, chances are, if it's on the eShop, you're gonna find out about it right here. But anyway, this has been the Budget Gamer, so as always, thanks for watching.